laughing and snapping and going set up this picnic basket. Fix the sandwich, happy laughing, trying to do that British accent. Kick it back, it's birds chirping, I got you in a good mood.
Hey, how's it going, everyone? Welcome to Awkward Situations, the series where you guys write awkward situations you've experienced or that you're currently experiencing, embarrassing stories, anything you want to share in the comment section below. And then I take a few of those comments and I discuss them in this series. I have some Fortnite gameplay in the background, I think. I haven't actually recorded the gameplay yet, but it is my current gaming addiction, and I can think of nothing that I want to do more after I record these awkward situations and play through some Fortnite, so hopefully that's not too boring. I'm kind of in the weird fall phase when there's not any games that I want to play that would be good for background games on videos like this. So I hope it doesn't look too weird with the face cam and the games going on, whatever. You guys usually don't care too much about that. I know a lot of you guys don't even watch the gameplay. You just listen to the commentary. So that's that. I appreciate you all for still watching this series. My favorite series to do on my channel. And I guess we'll get into our first update. We have an update today. Our update comes from a lady who was discussing on the previous episode of Awkward Situations, I believe, a situation in which her cousin told her friend, the woman's friend who wrote this comment, was told that the woman's friend, or the woman who wrote this comment's cousin, was engaged, and the engaged cousin and her fiance told this girl's friend that they were engaged but said not to tell anyone. But then this girl's friend told her, and then she asked her mom or something if it was true. And then the friend found out, and it was a whole ordeal. It sounded like the end of the world. It sounded like they would never be friends again. Lo and behold, update today. Hey, Joel, thanks for reading my comment. Sorry that it may have been confusing for you. It was confusing for all of us, but it's all right. But I think you summed it up pretty well. Awesome. I agree, and I think he needed to get over it as well because my engaged cousin was over it like 3 days later. But within the last week or so, my friend has started talking to me again, and he's even invited me to hang out with him. Word on the street is that he regrets acting out the way he did towards me, and I'm glad someone knocked some sense into him. I think the best way to react is just to pretend nothing happened because I'm not expecting an apology from him because he is a very prideful person. You're the best. Love you always. Yeah. If you can get over things in life, in general, your life is much easier. From my experience, I go through my daily life with anxiety, but I try not to get offended by things or take things too personally. People are always in their own heads about shit. So if they don't want to be a great person all the time, that's fine by me. I'll keep doing me, and I think the majority of the time it'll work out in my favor and in the favor of people who can let things go easily. So I'm glad you hit us up with this update. If you guys ever see your awkward situations in this series and you want to update me and update the audience, I always appreciate it. Without further ado, let's get into our first awkward situation right now. First awkward situation says, awkward situation. Hey Joel, I'm a senior in high school and have been dating my girlfriend for 6 months. Recently, my girlfriend gave me a BJ and it was not very good to say the least. I guess she saw this because she watched a porno to get better, somehow worked. But she said she masturbated to it, and it was guy and girl, obviously not the girl. She said she imagined me as the guy, but I still feel like maybe I'm not enough something, even though she says she was trying to learn to give better BJ. I'd really appreciate your advice. Even if you haven't had this happen to you, should I be concerned? Thank you. So normally I try to avoid talking about high school relationships in general because it makes me uncomfortable, but in particular, the things that happen in these high school relationships. But the thing that I wanted to key in on in this comment, which seems to be this person's worry and or frustration, is the my girlfriend watches porn, does that mean I'm not good enough part of the comment. I find that interesting because it's not something I've ever worried about in a relationship. I don't know how you all feel out there, women or men. It would be interesting to hear both perspectives. It seems like the porn watchers of the world are predominantly men, but it's interesting that he's coming at this from the male perspective, worrying about a female watching pornography and seeing huge honking dongs on her computer and liking what she's seeing. I feel in general that too much of anything is a bad thing for a person as an individual and in a relationship, because a relationship is just two individuals getting together and doing many things, but you know, if there's an issue with one person in the relationship, it causes issues or tensions with another person. So if someone is watching porn multiple times a day per week, that's a problem. If someone's eating a full jar of peanut butter 3 times a day each week, that's a problem. If someone's exercising too much and not spending enough time at home or with the person in the relationship, that's a problem. Too much of anything in life is usually a problem. Life is about balance. The act of actually watching porn and enjoying it, I'm speaking for myself, and I'm sure many others have different standards about this, but in a relationship, I don't see any issue with that. As long as you're not, like I said, being excessive about it, which is not a healthy habit in general, even if you weren't in a relationship, or taking things too far. Like, it's one thing to get in an incognito tab and browse some videos, boy or girl. It's another thing to maybe be in a My Free Cams chat room or something and donating to girls and or boys and saying, you know, hit your right testicle and say my name, Kathy, which is a really weird request, and it would take me a lot of tokens to do something like that. But as long as you're not proactively going outside the relationship, I just don't see any problem with watching pornography. I certainly do it on occasion to relax. I've done it a lot less since I've been in a relationship and gotten married, which I think is normal. But I don't know how to describe why I don't see a problem with that, other than if it's an excessive thing, that would be an issue. It is what it is, you know. You're in a relationship with one person, but it doesn't mean you can't watch other people do stuff. You can still be attracted to a person. It's not like when you get into a relationship, you go into this invisible prison cell where it makes other women and other men invisible to you. I think you guys heard that phrase, the tighter you hold on to something, the harder it is to hold on to it. That's not what the phrase is. What am I talking about? It's something like that. It's like the harder you want to hold on to something or someone, the more they want to be let go. You just made that shit up, Joel. But it's like you could still be attracted to other people if you're in a relationship. You just can't act on that. You know, you can't betray the reason you're in a relationship. And I think you're young. You're probably 17 or 18, and you're going to maybe not ever feel that way, but I think over time, if you're in good relationships, you'll feel more the way I feel. Hopefully. Hope that answers your question. I'm going to take my sweatshirt off. Second awkward situation says, hey, Joel, I was wondering if you could take a look at my awkward situation. I have the potential to get to a decently prestigious university for free tuition plus room plus etc. for 4 years out of state, but the problem arises with my mom. She has decently bad relationship with most of her family, including her children, on top of being decently poor. She does not want me to leave and wants me to attend a local university where the prospect of me getting a free education is non-existent, at least I think. Is it selfish for me to leave her and go off and study out of state? What makes the situation particularly difficult is the fact that she mostly lives off Social Security, which gets provided to her because of me, so once I leave, she will not have any source of income. She has no one in the family to talk with, and she has very little options ahead of her. She's also in her 50s, smokes, drinks, and is in general poor health, which makes me think she could die soon. My sister, which does not have the best relationship with my mom, tells me to screw her and let her figure it out on her own. I don't really want to do that to my mom's, but also the free education since I am a poor boy. What do I do, Daddy Joel? First of all, major props for doing so well in school, well enough that you have the potential to get a free education anywhere in the United States of America, which is a rare thing, and something I believe you should definitely take advantage of. I don't want to generalize about your mom. I hope I don't come off as insulting, but it sounds like that's the kind of thing she did not get in her life. She did not have the grades or have whatever to get a solid education in her life. And I don't know what the circumstances are that have caused her to be this way in her 50s. You said she smokes and drinks. Those are things that she could stop doing to improve her general health. And it sounds like she's in a situation, again, I don't want to sound like I'm insulting her, she's your mother, but she's in a situation where she is leeching off of you to get Social Security, and it's just not right. I mean, you can still love your mother. I don't think going off to school is you shunning your mother. I hope that she is intelligent enough to see, and I'm sure she is if she raised a son that has grades like you do, that she's intelligent enough to see that you doing this is you creating a better life for yourself and doing something that she would not be able to provide for you, unfortunately, which is the case in a lot of families. College is very expensive, and you've been given the opportunity for a great gift. Now, I think it's worth looking into local universities to see if you could get a scholarship elsewhere. I mean, in general, I know it costs money to apply, so don't stretch yourself, but in general, it's good to see what your options are for school, because the more options you have, the better. I don't know if I have a good reason for doing that, but I'm glad I applied to about five places just so I could really survey my options. So if you want to look at local schools, that's fine, but it seems like no matter where you go, even if it's local, she would still be losing out on this Social Security check, or she would have to claim you as a dependent still in a fraudulent manner, which I don't recommend her doing, but I know what happens. So either way, I just want you to understand that you can still be in a relationship with this person and still love this person and go do what is best for you. I'm lucky enough in my life to have not dealt with this situation, and I don't say that to sound braggadocious. I say that to be honest and try to make you understand I have not had this situation experienced in my life personally. I've experienced it secondhand. I've seen other people in my life who feel like they owe another person something because they love them, because they raise them, because they're a family member, because they're in love with them. That's a difficult social mine in life, social landmine to, or it's not even a landmine, it's more like a trap. You know, you just feel trapped by some false sense of entitlement to this person. Your mom wasn't with you in school taking those tests with you. I mean, maybe she helped you study, but you did all this on your own, and you deserve to have a great life, regardless of what is happening to your mom. I don't want to sound callous, but she is a 50-year-old woman in her mid-50s or whatever you said. She should be able to handle her own life. I don't have kids, but when I have kids, I know that the foremost thing in my life will be doing everything I can to make sure my kids have a great life and contribute to society in a positive way. And that's an unselfish thing. To have kids, you have to be unselfish in order to raise them correctly, I would assume. And for her to, I guess it sounds like you haven't even talked to her, by the way. It sounds like you, maybe you have, but you're kind of assuming things. So maybe I should even back up a little bit and just get her feelings on this. But regardless of what she says, I think you should do this. And you may feel like it's going to cause some permanent tension, but just think of it this way. Think of yourself in 10 years, let's say, my age. I'm 27. I just turned 27. Would you rather have a four-year education for free? By the way, this is such a lottery ticket in the United States. I cannot stress it enough. For free to have a four-year college degree and be able to apply to places and not even necessarily need to work so desperately. It really frees up your options for what you want to study if you can get a scholarship, because you won't start your career in a financial hole. And many people in my life, their net worth is negative $20,000 to $100,000. It's such a burden because you feel a lot of pressure to get a job quickly and to earn a lot of money quickly, and it makes you limit your options. But if you have the freedom to study what you want to study, like you're saying, you have so many options laid out for you, and it's going to be so good, and that's going to be a resume builder. You know, I got a scholarship to this university and I did well at the university. Or you could still be living with your mother, have little to no education experience. Maybe you could go to a community college, maybe you could take some online classes, and she would just be a burden on your life, and it would feel like she is, to be honest, ruining your life. So she could be happy with you while you're there, and she's leeching off you still, and it won't feel good for you, to be honest. Or you could do what's best for you. Maybe she'll be mad at you. Maybe she won't be. I don't know if you've talked to her. But you have to live your life regardless of what she's doing in her life. And really, if she's honest with herself deep down, I hope she could see that that is the smartest possible option. This shouldn't even be a question. I'm sorry that you had to write it and I hope you choose that path. Hey Joel, I don't really have an awkward situation, but I have a question. Should I get a job as a freshman in high school? I'm currently in 8th grade and 14 years old. Where I live, a grocery store accepts 14-year-olds as baggers. I think I want the job if I could get it, but I'm concerned that it would be hard as a freshman. I would be taking honors classes and then juggling the homework and work, so I'm conflicted. Anyone feel free to answer. Thank you. I know I have a while to think on it, but it's been on my mind lately. I thought this was an interesting question and worthy of discussion in the comments because I see a lot of comments about jobs and, I mean, if you guys have been watching Awkward Situations long enough, you know what all the topics are about, and we usually circle back around to topics after a few episodes, but it's worth talking about what age it's good to get a job and what age you should be thinking about stuff like this. I'm not a parent yet, as I've said, but if I had a child, I would probably have the same policy that my parents had. Once you turn 16 and you're able to legally obtain a driver's license in the United States of America, and you could drive yourself to your part-time job, that's when you should be searching for employment. It's not necessarily a thing where if I had a kid and their 16th birthday was on May 7th, I'm not going to break down their door on May 8th and say, get some job applications, motherfucker. I wouldn't sound like that, first of all. I'd have some weird voice box issues. And I wouldn't talk to my kids like that, but it's something you would suggest. Say, hey, you know, you're 16 now, maybe start applying for even a seasonal job. My brother and I both had seasonal jobs once we turned 16, working at golf courses over the summer. So you save up some money over the summer, and you don't need a lot of money in your life between the ages of 16 and 17 usually. So one summer of work, you know, getting out and doing something every day, or, you know, for 3, 4, or 5 days a week, gets you enough money to last you until the next summer between 16 and 17. And I worked there when I was 18 and 19 too. My sister, I believe, did not start working until she was 17 or 18. She worked as a waitress, which is not a seasonal job. So I think that it's good that you're thinking about it at this age. That's cool that you're even thinking about it to be able to make money on the side. Your most important thing right now, though, is doing well in school. Like you said, you're juggling honors classes. So if you feel like there's going to be even the slightest conflict in high school, you should err on the side of doing well in high school and then being able to, like we were just talking about in the last situation, get enough good grades that you could get a scholarship and get into a good school. If you want extra money, try to balance your time as well as possible. See if a grocery store would want to hire someone who's 14. I'm not trying to shit on your dreams, but in general, places of employment like you to be able to get there in a timely manner and have reliable transportation is usually what a lot of job applications will say. So maybe you live 3 blocks from this grocery store and you could just work there and that's not a concern. But, you know, where I live and not, I don't live in a big city per se. So a lot of people drive cars around here. If I didn't have a car, and I would just have trouble getting a lot of jobs. So that might be the situation for you, might be worth checking out. But I would say that your job right now is to get good grades in high school so you can go to college. And then in college, you're definitely gonna need to take on a part-time job, probably because there's a lot of stuff in college you'll wanna spend money on. Booze! And library books, you know, to learn stuff is what's important in college. So your main job right now is high school. If you feel like there's gonna be any problems balancing that in a job, I would just focus on trying to get a seasonal job once you're 16, or a part-time job that is really flexible for high school students once you're 16. But if you want to get one when you're 14 and you feel like you can balance it, by all means, do it. That's really cool. You're an awesome overachiever. If you're in honors or classes when you're in 14 and you're getting a job, you are on the right track in life. So props to you, man. But balance is the most important thing in life. It's probably the hardest thing to do in life, to balance your time and your relationships and making money, something you're never great at. Some people are better than others, something I struggle with every day. You're gonna find the older you get, the more the balance between time and relationships and family and career, it's really tough to juggle. So you're starting to think about it early, I guess that's good, but just do what's best for you. High school's a priority. Last awkward situation today. This might be a shorter episode. We're gonna end on a serious one. Hi, not that they're all serious, but this one's pretty heavy. Hi, Joel. I'm a junior in high school, and through the past years, I've come to the realization that I'm bisexual. And I've told a couple people, including my parents, and I would like to tell everyone and finally make it a part of who I am. But I'm on the wrestling team at my high school. I don't do it because of the guys. I do it because I like the sport and enjoy being physically fit. And I'm afraid it will cause a bunch of problems with me being in wrestling, mainly because no one will want to wrestle with the gay kid. And plus, the showers and locker room will become awkward for people. I don't look at people. I just get my stuff done and keep my eyes away. So I'm struggling if I should just come out and deal with the backlash of the team or just keep it to myself until college or something like that. This is one where ahead of time, I want to remind people that I am not a professional counselor or psychologist. I'm just giving my thoughts on these things, and I think it's interesting to have these discussions. So my word is not gold. Don't take anything I say the wrong way. And I also think on the situation, it's the kind of thing where there's no right or wrong answer. You just have to do what's best for you and what feels best for you. So no matter what I say, you have to do what feels right in your own heart, because ultimately you're the one that has to go to school every day and live with what's going on with whatever you choose. My first thought about this, though, and maybe this is just me being removed from high school and not really caring what other people on the streets are doing with their personal lives when I don't see them, strangers or whatever, is why you even need to tell people you're bisexual in general, or why you feel the need to. I don't want to sound insensitive. It's merely a question, because even if you're straight, maybe you like mayonnaise spread all over a girl, right? But you're straight, you like women, but you like mayonnaise spread all over a girl. And that's kind of odd. That's, you know, not the normal thing you see in the movies. Or maybe you're gay, but you like to wear birthday party hats when you do gay stuff with your gay guy or girl, you know? So we're all into weird stuff as humans. Maybe we're not into weird stuff. Maybe. So no, some of you guys are really, you're sitting there thinking, I'll walk down this path with you, Joel, but we don't know where we're going. You're leading us down a weird, windy road of conversation. We don't know where you're taking us. You gotta follow me. You gotta trust me. It almost feels like my advice won't make sense to this question, because I'm now remembering that in high school, everyone cares about everyone's business, and it's so important to climb the social ladder. And then when you get out of high school, you realize how fake all of that is and how much it doesn't matter. It feels like the biggest thing in the world when you're in high school to maintain some fake persona. I used to tell all of my friends about all the hip-hop I listened to, and I do love hip-hop, but I oversold how much I loved hip-hop and how much I cared about hip-hop, when in reality, I listened to a lot of alternative music. I really like My Chemical Romance, and I didn't tell anyone that in high school because I thought it would create some weird persona around me. The dumbest thing. Not even, you know, what kind of genitals I like in my mouth. Just that I fucking listen to My Chemical Romance. So I want to sympathize with you in that sense. That this, it seems obvious to me as an adult, but when you're in that situation in high school, it feels a lot more difficult to deal with the social ladder aspect of all of this. But it just should not matter to anyone else what you do in your personal life. And I'm sorry that you have to even be concerned about it. But again, I come back to the question, does it matter that anyone else knows? If you want to tell people, if you want to make it a part of your resume, like, hey, I'm Dave, I like dicks and vaginas, I have multiple options. That's kind of cool. But if you don't want to make it a part of your persona, and you can just, you know, you told your parents, which I think is really cool, and you told a couple of friends, and if other people find out, you'll be like, yeah, that's the truth. So what of it? That's fine, but I'm kind of wondering what coming out is to you. So that's one interesting part of it. And I hope that doesn't sound insensitive. I, to be honest with you, don't have any close gay friends, so I've never talked to them about that experience of going public with something like that. And I feel like coming out in general, it's less of a, I remember back in 1996 when Ellen DeGeneres came out, I think it was in 1996, it was something like that, when Ellen DeGeneres came out as a gay celebrity, it was a big deal. But, you know, in 2017, I don't think it would be such a big deal. And that's a really good thing, because it just shows you that social norms are changing. And all this stuff is becoming more normal. But as for what I would do in your situation, again, I can't speak for you, so I don't want to put too many ideas in your head. I'm just thinking about these things and thinking about how I would react. As someone who played a sport and someone who had to shower with other guys, I don't know how 18-year-old me would react. In general, I think everyone feels uncomfortable in the showers. I don't know if I would feel more uncomfortable if there was someone who likes penises in the shower. I mean, I have this theory that everyone is at least a percentage gay. Maybe some people are 1% gay. I think I'm about 15% gay because I don't like pornography if the dick is small. I can't watch it, and that's on me as a human. It's not even like I have a huge dick. It's not like, oh, my dick is, you know, mine's like average size. But if it's too small, I can't watch it. It has to be a nice, thick thing. So if everyone's honest with themselves, there's straight, to categorize yourself, there's blurred lines with things. And like you said, you like the sport. You know, wrestling isn't even an intimate act. It's not like people go to wrestling matches and they're like, oh, this is hot as fuck. I mean, you're really being pretty rough with people. I mean, some people are into that, you know? Some people like mayonnaise spread on women. Some people like to be rough with each other. It's a thing. But it's not an intimate act. So I hope that people on the wrestling team would be intelligent enough to understand that, you know, you don't get more points on the mat for grabbing someone's dick. So you're trying to do what you like. And I feel like I did not do a great job answering your question, but I just, more than anything, want you to know, regardless of what you choose to do in high school, this is not an issue outside of high school. It's not something that you have to worry about. And it sounds like you're pretty comfortable with yourself, even as a young individual. So just, I'll give you that solace and let you know that this feels like probably a big thing to you right now, but it won't be such a big thing after high school. And I think the best thing to do would just be, I'd be more interested in just having a conversation with you about it, but I just, what is coming out, you know, just if some people know and they say, yeah, I'm gay, so what of it? I'll fucking make you tap out, you little bitch. That's, I don't know. I hope you're doing well. And I appreciate you giving that comment and that perspective, because it's something that I don't think about a lot. And I think probably a lot of people in the comments don't think about, you know, how to feel comfortable being yourself in the world. And it's something that gets easier as you get older. But I hope you figure it out. I'm sorry I don't have a do this, do that answer for this situation. I don't have that for many situations. So don't feel bad. Thanks for watching this episode of Awkward Situations, guys. I hope you enjoyed. Hope we learned a little bit. And I hope you all out there have a great day. Until next time, bye. My life, but that's real shit. Things. No, we don't need a plan. Oh boy, I'm fucking with you. We can see.